Hey everyone, Vinayak here. Upgrading to a more powerful Ryzen 7 5800X from a Ryzen 5 3600, the cooling needs would increase due to the higher TDP. So to make sure that the temperatures are kept controlled, I installed the Deepcool Gamer Storm Castle 240 V2 AIO. That was a mouthful, but was it worth it? Find out in this video.
I have here the Deepcool Gamer Storm Castle 240 V2 AIO. An AIO is an all-in-one cooler solution which uses liquid to cool your CPU. The AIO combines a water block, radiator, tubes, fans, fittings, and the pump into one sleek package. I had a L120 earlier, which, as the name suggests, has a 120mm radiator and effectively only one 120mm fan. The Castle 240 has a 240mm radiator with two fans. The fans and the pump support ARGB and can be controlled by most big brand RGB sync software. This is the 240mm radiator, which is pre-connected to a pump. This kit is great for system builders who want water cooling without the hassle of running custom water loops. This is the first box within. Wow, there's a lot inside. Here's the manual. Important, as there's a lot in this box. Very pictorial, which is both a boon and a curse. Find your CPU and mount type and follow the instructions. I have an AM4 socket, which is for AMD. Intel has their LGA socket types, and the mount would be different. We have two included hubs, one to connect the fan's PWM control, and the other for ARGB to control the colors. It's great that we have these hubs included in the box. These are some conversion adapter cables between the types of ARGB headers, as the cooler uses a custom header. If you don't have an ARGB header, you can also use this SATA connector for power and install the remote instead. Here are the mounting brackets. The pack has brackets for both Intel and AMD motherboards. This mounting bracket is Intel on one side and AMD on the other. Here's the provided fan. The rubber on the screw holes would dampen the sounds caused by vibrations. This is the PWM connector for powering the fan, and the other is an ARGB header. We are provided two in the box, as we have a 240mm radiator, which is 2 into 120mm. Here's the radiator, which would cool the liquid as it passes through. The fans are installed onto it. We have a warranty void if removed sticker here. This could be the inlet for the liquid during manufacturing. AIOs are generally not user serviceable, so better not to open it. Here's the pump with pre-applied thermal paste. The pump has a large copper contact area below it, which should help transfer the heat from the CPU more optimally. The AIO makes water cooling much easier for people who don't want to get into the hassle of building their own custom loops. The radiator and the pump are connected using braided tubes, which contain a liquid coolant. Deepcool has an anti-leak technology, which has the tubes be able to release pressure when necessary. Set up the mounting bracket, add the long screws and plastic bushes onto the correct branch. Currently, I'm using a 120mm AIO, which could work, but as the 5800X is a higher TDP processor, which is 105 watts as compared to only 65 watts on the 3600, I am replacing the AIO with a new one. Let's begin the AIO teardown. First, we remove the fan, next the radiator, and finally the AIO pump. Also remove the graphic card for more space to work within. These earlier front intake fans need to be uninstalled and replaced with the radiator and its fans. Okay, all these are removed, and the system is now ready for the new AIO. Get the mounting bracket ready and install it from behind the motherboard. As my cabinet is horizontal, I need to install it from the bottom. We place the 5800X into the CPU socket, matching the triangle mark with the one on the socket. Clamp down the lever, and the processor is installed. The AIO has pre-applied thermal paste. Be careful not to touch it while adding these brackets to the AIO pump. Look for the small depression on each of the brackets. These are to be facing away from the pump and would allow the mounting screw to lie flush in line with the bracket. Install the pump over the CPU and screw it down with the thumb screws provided. The pump is ready. Now we know how far we can pull at the tubes while we install the radiator and the fans. Here's where I'm installing the radiator, and the fans would mount from the front. We would use these long screws to mount the fans onto the radiator. Now for the connections. We use the provided hubs to make the appropriate connections. The pump fan header directly goes into the pump header on the motherboard. This is the PWM fan speed controller. We have two fans in our AIO which need to be connected to this controller. And the output goes to the PWM CPU header. This keeps both the fans at the same speed. Next is the RGB hub, which allows the fans to sync to the same color scheme and animations and allows to connect more fans to one ARGB header. These fans use a custom connector, which is why the hub is necessary, else the fans can generally daisy chain between them. Connect the RGB headers to the controller and the controller to the ARGB header on the motherboard, generally marked J Rainbow 1 or 2, as per the number of headers you have on the motherboard. Now let's peel off the plastic film on the pump and boot up the system. The pump and the fan support ARGB effects, which can be controlled using the corresponding RGB software as per the motherboard manufacturer. I use Dragon Center as I have a MSI motherboard. These are a few effects available. We can also run multiple fan profiles as per the task being performed. If we need the system to be silent, especially during times when we record videos, we can use the silent mode. And this is how it sounds. Balanced is good if we have standard workloads and the system ramps up the fans as necessary. This is the best for most users. And here's how it sounds. Extreme performance is for users who have overclocked the system and want it running at the highest performance. This ramps up the fans to their stop speed and makes the highest noise. And this is how it sounds. The pump is relatively quiet and it's more the fans on the radiator that makes the maximum noise as they ramp up and down. That aside, we installed the cooler to keep our CPU cool. So let's check the temps while running some processor intensive tasks. Here's Cinebench R23, Blender BMW Scene Render, gaming is more GPU bound, but let's have a look at the temperatures. Shadow of the Tomb Raider. Next is 3D Mark, where you have Time Spy. And Port Royal.
The AIO is doing a great job keeping the temperatures low. The only time it closes in on 90s is during the Cinebench or Blender rendering tests, where the processors are being run at the highest speed all the time. The processor would run well up to 90 degrees centigrade without any thermal throttling. And the AIO looks to be able to keep it under the 90 degrees mark. Standard use, the temps are quite controlled, with the temperatures crossing 70 degrees only when loading up the game or between levels. Once within the game, the temperatures are around 40 to 60 degrees max. If I had used my older 120mm AIO, it would have heated up quite a bit. The GamerStorm Castle 240 RGB V2 does manage to maintain low temperatures, which I am happy about. I am not overclocking the processor, so I don't expect temperatures that high. There are methods to undervolt the processor to get better temps, but I'm happy with how it is right now. So what do you guys think? Could I cool the processor better using some other tech? Comment below. Also make sure to like, subscribe and hit the notification bell to be informed when new videos are added. Thank you for watching and see you all next time.